to welcome everyone on behalf of the Center for Latin American Studies. I'm Harley Shaken, the chair of the center, and we're really honored to have our speaker with us tonight. Celso Amorim has played not simply an important role, but a defining role in foreign policy for Brazil, and really more broadly for Latin America. He was at the forefront. In fact, in many ways, he was the key architect of Brazil's international relations at a particularly pivotal period during the presidency of Lula for 7 years. During this period, he defined a newly assertive foreign policy for Brazil, which of course has had historic and lasting repercussions, not simply in Latin America, but throughout the world. He will be speaking today in part on his latest book, Acting Globally, Memoirs of Brazil's Assertive Foreign Policy. It was both an assertive foreign policy, an innovative foreign policy, but to some, a surprising foreign policy, particularly coming from Brazil, but it defined a new era and some critical new approaches. Three areas in the book and in the reality of the time stand out. One was Brazil's diplomatic efforts for a peaceful negotiated settlement to the Iranian nuclear issue. A second was Brazil's diplomatic efforts in relation to the Middle East. And finally, the country's leading role in the Doha Round of multilateral trade negotiations. Each of these three areas could use a book. Each of these three areas broke new ground and put forward new policy ideas, really underscoring Brazil's new role on a global stage. But in the book, the narrative takes the reader on a journey behind the scenes of global politics, combining detailed accounts of international relations with very insightful insights into what took place and interacting with global leaders. I can't resist just reading a few names. Hillary Clinton, George W. Bush, Barack Obama, Mahmoud
Abbas,
yes. Tony Blair, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad as well, and Benjamin Netanyahu. What do these very, very different figures have in common? Our speaker tonight interacted with all of them in a very upfront, direct, and compelling way. He will speak, and then we will have time for questions and discussions. Please join me in welcoming Celso Amorim.
It's a great honor for me, of course, to be here this evening, this afternoon. Berkeley certainly was always present in the imagination of people my generation, and rather old guys, so I can say that, for different reasons, as a place of freedom, a place of political engagement. That was really very much, I always had a great curiosity. I had been here before as a tourist in San Francisco, and I came to Berkeley, but I had never been in the university itself. And it surprises me in many respects, including the beauty of the place, and also the fact that I was admitted today for lunch in a women's club, which was very much, I was very much proud of, because one of the things that we did in the Foreign Minister in Brazil was to increase very much the participation of women in leading roles. I mean, for the first time, I mean, let me maybe brag a little bit about that. For the first time, we had the permanent representative at the United Nations in at Geneva for the Human Rights Council and other bodies, and in many for the UNESCO. All that happened during our, and never happened before. There was one or two ambassadors, not normally in most prominent posts. So I was very happy. So again, having coming to the Women's Club here was, I think I found it as a sort of gratifying.
The book is here, you don't need to buy, but at least you might wish to have a look at the cover. And so I'll start with the cover and then the title. The cover is the reproduction of a map. The map is from early 16th century, 1510 or something like that, by an Italian cartographer. And it has three or four characteristics, which I will mention. One, it's the first map, as far as we know, the first map in which the name Brazil appeared, or better said, in which Brazil appeared with its current name, Brazil. Previous, I mean, the Portuguese had other names like Terra de Santa Cruz and some other things. Second, it has, as you see, Jerusalem at its center. So when you deal with international affairs, we are very much there yet, I mean, with Jerusalem at the center. Third, and maybe the most striking one, and the one that was made the map a piece of conversation, is that you have the south on top, with Africa very much prominent, which is also very important from the point of view of our foreign policy, and the north below, down. So these three, of course, people are used to see the other way, but people forget that it is a pure convention. I mean, when you look at from the point of view of an astronaut, you don't really know what is on top or what is below. And so it was an interesting conversation, because great part of our effort in foreign policy, not the only one, but was to increase our relations with other countries of the South, so to say, the political South of the world. And we didn't do that in a way, contrary to what the Brazilian media very often allege, in rivalry with the North or in opposition to the North. We act on the contrary, you know, continue to have a very good and very, actually, even more active relations with the United States, with the European Union. The only thing that we didn't maybe do was to accept their agenda as a definitive one. So when I wrote this book in Portuguese, assertive is a way of translating a combination of words which would not read well in English, which was ativa and altiva. Ativa is active, and altiva is something like self-confident, something like that. So this is also something that I want to mention, because it's the origin not only of the book, but how I saw foreign policy when I was invited, and how Brazilian foreign policy should be when I was invited by President Lula, whom I hardly had met before. I had seen him once. It's a very interesting fact that also I mentioned to you, because very often our foreign policy and the policy of the government, which was, of course, of the Workers' Party, was accused of being partisan and being ideological. But the choice of President Lula was not of a person, and certainly not someone who belonged to the PT. I didn't belong to the PT then. But his first choice was to have someone who, let us say, was a civil servant, a servant of the state, so to say, and in this particular case, a diplomat. I had been minister before in a short government of President Itamar Franco, so I was, as a diplomat, I was rather well known in Brazil, but not. So he chose, first of all, to have a diplomat. Then, among the diplomats that he had to select, for some reason, he selected me. I mean, I don't want to go into that, because it's not an autobiography that I want to do that, but I just explain
that when I had the two opportunities to talk with Lula. I started the first one and said broadly what I thought that we should do in foreign policy. And then he invited me for a second talk. In the middle of the talk, he said, I want to invite you to be my foreign minister. I said, oh my God. So I was too prepared to go along with the 1 hour dissertation. He cut short with that comment. It was a very moving moment for me. But what I want to say is that it took some time between that decision that he communicated to me and the formal announcement. The day of the formal announcement, there were four ministers that were whose names were announced at the same time. So I say, well, and Lula was going to be there. So I think, well, I have to say, we had to speak to the press. Say, I have to say something short because, you know, I can't really. Well, first, I can't. Everybody wants to listen to Lula, not to me or to the other minister. Maybe I don't know, but certainly not to me. On the other hand, I have to say something meaningful. So it's very difficult when you have to have only 3 minutes or 4 minutes to say something meaningful. Say, and I can't go subject by subject first because only mentioning the subject would probably take about half an hour. Second, because I hadn't really discussed them with the president, so it was difficult to summarize. So I said, well, I'll not concentrate so much on the position on each subject, but I'll concentrate on the attitude that I think the Brazilian government should have in foreign policy. And now this links up with something that I had read of a Mexican author who had been foreign minister in a different period, a person, a very intelligent man with whom I not always agreed. But I think this was something that struck me and kept in my mind. When I was minister for the first time, 1993-94, that was a different period. It was also a kind of transition government that followed an impeachment of a president, Collor. So it was President Tomás Franco, very honest and progressive man, very important, by the way, because it was during his government that this macroeconomic stability plan was devised under the leadership of then finance minister Fernando Henrique Cardoso. So it was important, but short, so it couldn't run out. So at that time, we did many important things, I believe, including the conclusion of the institutional part of Mercosul. Those who are familiar with Latin America know what it means, and I, of course, can talk about that later on. And also the common external tariff for Mercosul, which also gained a very important aspect, makes Mercosul different from other. When people compare, for instance, with the so-called alliance for the Pacific, they forget that Mercosul is a customs union, very imperfect one, but it's aiming at that direction. The alliance for the Pacific are countries that have, all of them, free trade agreements, but they are not aiming at having a common economy in the way that Mercosul, at least in theory, is aiming at. But anyway, so they did important things, but at that time, I read an article which appeared, I believe, in New York Times, but I think I read it in the International Herald Tribune at the time, which we used to reproduce one day later. It's much better to read because the International Herald Tribune already had a selection of what was more relevant internationally rather than just the results of baseball or whatever, from our point of view, or what happened to some bear in a zoo in some place, so in Brooklyn or whatever. So we had the Herald Tribune, and the article by Jorge Castañeda, a famous Mexican author and politician, the title of the article was something like, Brazil is a country that punches below its weight. And that caused me a big impression, you know, and I reflect on that. Well, very difficult to translate in Portuguese, by the way, because, I mean, boxing is not so popular and we don't have this kind of metaphors. To find a metaphor in football for the Brazilians were here, I said, um país que joga abaixo da sua liga, something like that. But anyway, so I did this off of my head. And well, I did many interesting things when I was, as I said, minister for Franco, but well, the time was limited and so on, so this is off of my head. So one thing that I thought when Lula was elected is that, well, now Brazil is in a slightly, so why was that? Well, why Brazil is a country that punches below its weight? Well, first you have to understand what that means. Well, of course, I mean, don't, for you that are, most of you, I suppose, are Latin American scholars, don't want to be speaking too much, but you know, it's fifth country in territory in the world, fifth country in population, one of the 10 biggest economies. At a certain point, it was even the seventh, and now got down a little bit, but anyway. So, anyway, these characteristics, other characteristics that I, as Minister of Defense, later on came also to give value, and which people don't think. Brazil has borders with 10 different countries, 10 different countries, and about 10,000 miles of borders, and we haven't had a war in our region for almost 150 years. So this is a very rare record. I think two countries, as far as I know, have more borders than Brazil, China and Russia. Well, they cannot say that they haven't had a war in the lab. Brazil was not had, never had a war in the 150 years, except the Second World War, in which Brazil, well, I can go on and on about that, but in which Brazil joined the Allied forces against fascism. And very curious, by the way, because we had a government that was authoritarian with some sympathies for the fascism, but I think it was, well, there are several reasons. This is another object of another talk, maybe. But anyway, so that was the only way of war that we've actually fought, and it was the only Latin American country actually to send troops to Europe, and actually, as Minister of Defense, I said how much they cherish the memoirs of what they had done. But anyway, but I think the fact that I want to stress is that having borders with 10 countries and not having a war tells a lot about the power of Brazilian diplomacy. So that's not the power of a particular individual, although there was a particular individual that was very important for that, with Rio Branco, those who know Brazilian history know about that. But you know, its diplomacy was very strong. How can you have borders with 10 countries? And we had difficulties because we inherited the rivalries between the Portuguese and the Spanish empires, and all these had to be solved. And quite astonishingly, in a way, all were solved peacefully, by dialogue, by negotiation. So I think that's ingrained in the mentality of Brazilian diplomats. And I think this ingrained somehow, well, at the time I wouldn't say that because I didn't know the concept, but in our soft power, so to say. But so all these characteristics, the size of the economy, the size of the population, and so on, plus this capacity of solving problems diplomatically was a source of inspiration that made it possible for us to venture in many diplomatic efforts. And that's why I use these words, ativa and altiva, because so I summarized when I presented to the press. Well, we were going to have a foreign policy that's ativa and altiva, which will be assertive and self-confident. And why did I say that? Well, I had been ambassador before in many places, and very often Brazil had, in my opinion, the correct position, but always a bit too cautious. That's the question of punching below its weight. Not so much maybe in the trade area, but not maybe so much in Latin America and South America, because of course these were our borders. But when it came to the world at large, we were much more cautious, and always I received an instruction, you can go that way, but please avoid irritating the West, or well, they wouldn't say the US, I mean, avoid irritating the big powers or other actors, I mean, if they want to be more subtle, or have a look at how the expression that was very common in the instructions, I was ambassador in multilateral bodies, they called it, have a look at the parliamentary picture. So that meant that don't do something that you'll be alone or whatever, and that you'll be the object or the focus of any kind of strong reaction. So I had sources of inspiration. And when I was very young, I never thought of being a diplomat. By the way, at the time I was involved in film and other maybe more interesting things, fiction. Maybe I had a lot of fiction in my mind, and that's why I was able to be a bit innovative in diplomacy as well, I don't know. But the notion at least of a roadmap, I mean, the of a scenario that has to be developed. But one of the sources of inspiration for my generation in Brazil was a foreign minister who was, curiously enough, he was foreign minister only for 8 months. But he left his imprint in Brazilian foreign policy. He was the one who actually conceptualized at the time of the Brazilian what Skidmore called an experiment in democracy. We were more or less at the end of that experiment because the military coup followed 2 or 3 years later. Santiago Dantas is a very famous, less famous than he should be actually in Brazil, but he was very famous to my generation and very much a source of inspiration. And actually the first narrative of this book, which is about our efforts together with Turkey to bring Iran to the negotiating table, to make a confidence building gesture that would allow further negotiations later on. When I think of what we did, I see that it has a lot to has a lot in common with what this man, Santiago Dantas, thought as the role of Brazil. And he wrote something in 1961, when in a speech to the Chamber of Deputies in Brazil, he said something that I'll just read to you because I think it is important. And he said, after some other comments, also, and so, he said, today, by the way, it's an important point in his practical actions, when he was foreign minister, there was a vote to expel or to suspend, more technically said, to suspend Cuba from the Organization of American States. And Brazil was one of the few countries that abstained. Abstention in the OAS is equivalent to voting no, because you have to have a certain number of positive votes. So abstaining, we actually voted no. The resolution passed anyway, but that that was seen as a kind of a rebellious act in Brazil. That's in a conference of Punta del Este. Of course, those who study Brazilian foreign policy don't know that very well. So he said, and so today, Santiago Dantas said, our country is no longer as it might have appeared to the idealistic generation who participated in the hopes and failures of the League of Nations, because Brazil also participated, a secondary country destined in world politics to play the role of mere accomplice, albeit often a little illustrious one. Our responsibilities today, he was speaking in 1961, our responsibilities today are already those of a country that can speak for others. Today, above all, we are able to make an impartial contribution, not only to solving problems in which we find ourselves directly implicated, but also to solving other problems, which we contemplate from a distance, but which we, like any other mature people, feel a responsibility to deal with in a positive way. So that's really what inspired us. When people would ask me, but why Brazil should meddle in the Middle East? Why should meddle with the Palestine and Israel, such a difficult question? Why should we deal with the question of the nuclear program in Iran? Well, that is the source of inspiration. Nothing can be indifferent to us and to any country, by the way, but Brazil, because of the several characteristics that I already mentioned, could have a possibility. And I just mentioned one or two aspects of, for instance, of our efforts in relation to the that's where Hillary Clinton and some other figures appear. Bush appears more in the trade part, actually. He was very interested in the trade, and many of our conversations with President Lula, of course, but I was also present. But in the Iranian question was more President Obama. Our involvement, well, first, I had some knowledge of, because I had, when I was ambassador to the UN, I was chairman of three panels that were created by the Security Council, actually, when Brazil was in the presidency, to deal with the question of Iraq. I don't know how closely you have accompanied that, but in December 1998, there was the so-called Desert Fox operation, which was an armed attack on Iraq without authorization of the Security Council, and based on a report that was made by the then secretary, or chairman actually, of the UNSCOM, which was the committee that studied, and without the Security Council even having time to analyze the report. So that created a big impasse at the Security Council. It was not even possible to have any discussion, not only on Iraq, but on anything else, because when the United States would start speaking, the Russian would raise his hand, oh, we don't want to discuss that before we discuss this action, or vice versa, for some reason. And so it was important to make the Security Council work. Three panels were created, and I, after leaving actually the presidency of the Security Council, I was appointed to chair this. So I these three panels. The most important one, of course, was the one on disarmament. But also there was one on humanitarian questions, which was very important, and people sometimes don't realize that because of the sanctions, whether they are deserved or not, it's another matter, but because of the sanctions, Iraq had come from a state of development which was similar to the low, let us say, to the some of the lower, less developed countries in Europe, like, let us say, Portugal or Greece, similar level of development, maybe not with the same kind of distribution, but a similar level, to a state in which was like a least developed country. And then like Zimbabwe or Haiti or whatever. And that was really the work of the sanctions, I mean, which affected in a horrible way questions of health, education, and so on. And you can imagine, I cannot give you one example. I'm sorry to be diverting a little bit from the central objective, but all that was really clear to me. They could not buy graffitis, I don't know how to say that in English, for pencils, because graffitis can be in very large quantities used also as a moderator for nuclear reactors. But you can imagine, not to speak about tires that could also be used for military vehicles and things like that. So it was a horrible thing. The water, the sanitation also was affected, many other things. So I had this feeling, and at the time, we were able to talk to the Russians, to the Americans, and I could see that really Brazil could have a role. And I had relations with many people that were involved in the efforts in relation to Iran, like El Baradei, who was the Director General of the Atomic Agency in Vienna, and Javier Solana, who was the High Representative for Foreign Policy for Europe. So these people knew me, I knew them, so we had all these conversations about that. But really, we got involved in the Iranian question by a request of President Obama. In a meeting in Italy in 2009, just after actually the earthquake that had happened in central Italy, and actually the city that had been affected, L'Aquila, and the main subject of that conference, which was a conference of G8 plus, I mean the famous G8, G7 plus Russia. Now we don't have G8 anymore because Russia doesn't participate. But anyway, there was G8 plus, and the plus normally included at least five countries: Mexico, Brazil, India, China, and South Africa. And sometimes there was also another country or in the Arab world or something like that. But normally it was G8 plus 5, it was almost a constant for 4 or 5 years we had meetings like that. And so during this meeting, whose main subject was climate change in preparation for the Copenhagen conference that happened in the end of 2009, in this, Obama requested to see President Lula. And of course, we were delighted with the request. Obama was a new president. I think it was the first time they met. I'm not sure about that. But anyway, one of the first times, because it was July 2009. And in that meeting, the main subject was Iran, brought by President Obama. And he started by saying, well, I'll make some general comments. And then he said, well, I reached out to Iran, extended my hand, and I was not corresponded. Which was true, by the way, because the Ayatollah, the supreme leader, was not interested in having relations with the United States because it's part of, let us say, of their power to have this rivalry or this enmity also. So, and he said, well, I reached out to Iran, and then he went on speaking about the nuclear program of Iran, which was a source of preoccupation for Israel, but a source of preoccupation in the Middle East, in general, for the world at large. And then, I mean, after speaking a little bit about that, he said to President Lula, when we were going out, actually, he said, I didn't have a tape recorder with me, so I don't know the exact words, but that's what I remember, and I'm repeating in very good faith. He said, about speaking about the problem with the nuclear program and so on, he said, and I need friends who can talk to the people that we cannot talk to. So it was clearly understood. They were asking us, Brazil, Lula, but I was the chief diplomat, to deal with this question of Iran. And I mean, if we had not understood, two months later, U.S. envoys started coming to explain to us the agreement that they had actually proposed to Iran, that a certain point called the swap agreement, whoever studies the history will see, if you look in the Google or whatever, you look at swap agreement, you'll find what it is. I don't want to go into detail. I'll mention very briefly, maybe. It was an agreement which Iran almost agreed with. The negotiator of Iran agreed, but then they backtracked. They backtracked probably because of the reaction of the Ayatollahs, and even of the opposition, the guy that was very much supported by the West, supported theoretically, Mousavi, I believe was his name, if I'm not mistaken, reacted saying that it would be an abdication of sovereignty if the Iran did that. Well, so what we started then to work. Ahmadinejad was scheduled to have a visit to Brazil because we were always proud of having relations with everyone. You don't need to agree with the country to have. For instance, I was very much criticized when I opened an embassy in North Korea. Well, but we have to know what happened there, and we have to know from our own means, not through the opinion of others. And when people say, oh, but why Brazil doesn't, well, the UK also has an embassy in North Korea. They don't agree with the North Korea regime, but they have an embassy there. So we also had good, normal relations with Iran, and President Ahmadinejad was going to visit Brazil. So that's probably what originated the whole conversation with Obama. And I received the names and so on are all mentioned here in the book, but I don't need to go to that now. We did receive envoys, and to explain to us what this, I already had an idea with my talks with Solana and El Baradei, who were very much in favor of having proceeding on that line. Unfortunately, both of them left office more or less at the same time, in September or October 2009, explaining to me in detail how the swap agreement would work, which was basically, to make just a summary, exchange, it would be an exchange of light enriched uranium, 3 or 4% enriched uranium, which is basically used for electricity, but which can be re-enriched and then become maybe weapons grade, to exchange this for fuel for their research reactor, which produces medical isotopes, basically for treatment and diagnosis of cancer. And just one point that has to be clear, because people might attend, the fuel, although it uses uranium enriched at 20%, it cannot be, or it's very difficult technologically, to be reconverted into an uranium that can then be re-enriched. So it's more or less as if you have done something else with it and you cannot come back. So that was the exchange. There was a calculation even what were the proportions and so on, so that uranium, in that way, you would deprive Iran of a quantity of uranium that could be used potentially for a nuclear weapon. By the way, let me say, the quantity that Iran had was a very small quantity, maximum one nuclear bomb. Maybe the calculations vary. I'm not a scientist myself, so I don't know what I have heard. But I have heard, even in Israel, one, maybe two. And two nuclear weapons are certainly not an arsenal, I think. Two nuclear weapons are a passport for suicide. I don't know. Maybe some people are trying to have that now. I don't know. But in any case, but we were trying to work on that. And the Brazil started working and trying to convince. When I managed to head to Brazil, I made several trips to Iran myself. And at a certain point, we discovered that we knew that Turkey was doing similar efforts. I don't know if it was because of their proximity or if they were also spurred by the United States or some other countries, but they were doing similar efforts, so we decided to join efforts. Well, and it's a long story, and I'll try to make it as short as possible. We worked on that path, and after 6 months or so of negotiations, we were able to convince Iran to accept the three basic conditions that the West, especially the United States, had presented. And I just mentioned two episodes, which that happened in May 17th. Actually, when that happened, Le Monde, you studied in France, but I mean, it's not something of little importance, said a historic date, because in the end it was not. Maybe it's for a footnote of history, but anyway, because they thought it was a big step towards solving the nuclear impasse. But I want to say, mention two aspects. I don't know if I can go through all the narratives. It would take too long. Maybe I concentrate on that, and then if there are questions, I can mention the others. So, as we moved on, and also because Iran dragged its feet, it's not easy to negotiate with the Iranians at all. I mean, and they say, well, they're asking us to give 1,200 kilos, which was what they originally had, of light enriched uranium, to give us 120 kilos of fuel. But we don't need 120 kilos of fuel. It's like asking someone who has a car which will only last 5 years to buy a spare part for 10 years. So that was the kind of reasoning that they were having. Then they were also asserting that in order to be fair, the agreement, the handling of the uranium they had, the delivery should take place simultaneously with the reception of the fuel. Well, in principle, it's reasonable. The problem is that the fuel doesn't exist on the shelf. I mean, it takes 1 year or so, at least 1 year to produce it, and that would be too long in terms of the confidence, in terms of the purposes of the swap agreement. And there was a third important aspect. It was where it should be put. Iran insisted that because of sovereignty reasonings, it had to be in Iranian territory itself, even if it were under the accepted that it would be under the Atomic Agency supervision, but in Iranian, they even offered a place on an island, which is a kind of free trade zone and so on. And the West and the United States in particular were insisting, no, it has to be 1,200 kilos. It has to be in another country. Delivered in another country, and it cannot be simultaneously. They have to give it immediately. So these are the three main elements. At a certain point, we had the impression that the agreement would not go because Iran was dragging its feet. We came here to Washington in a meeting on nuclear security. Both then Prime Minister, now President, very powerful President Erdogan, and President Lula had a meeting with President Obama, of course, I and Hillary and Davutoglu, the Turkish Foreign Minister, and some others participated in the meeting, and the meeting didn't go well. I mean, we found that Obama was a bit irritated. He was saying, well, I cannot be patient with the Iranians anymore, have the Israeli putting pressure. I thought, well, why is the United States worried with pressure from Israel? It should be the other way around. I don't know. After all, the United States is the most powerful country. But anyway, that was how it happened. So we went back and I told the president, that's finished. That won't go. That almost exactly as I'm saying, maybe the difference of a day or two, 1 week later, we received a letter. We, not majestatically, let's say, President Lula received the letter, but as usually these things, they are handed to the foreign minister, so I could read even before discussing with the president. But President Lula received the letter by President Obama, and we learned later that Prime Minister Erdogan received the same letter, with differences only on the titles or whatever, reaffirming what were the essential elements. And these were exactly the same that they had from the beginning. 1,200 kilos in another country and immediately. So no playing with this, with numbers or with places or timing. And that's very interesting because these are three very much verifiable things. I'm not a physicist, but you know, these are very physical things, quantity, place, and time. So it was not something that you said, well, but how can you rely on them? Well, if they don't do that, you're free to impose the sanctions anyway. And there was a fourth condition also, which appeared in the letter, which you knew, by the way, which was of a formal nature, but also very important, that Iran would not only commit itself in a letter to Brazil or to Turkey, but they should write to the International Atomic Agency. Actually, Hillary Clinton always told me that. They knew whom they should write to. They know the address of the Atomic Agency. I said, okay. So, well, 3 days before we left for a trip, which included Iran, it started with some other countries. We went to Russia, and then the president went to Qatar. I went from Russia to Iran. Three days before, Hillary Clinton called me, practically to try to dissuade us from going to Tehran. something that would be totally impossible. It was a state visit and so on, and President Lula would also participate in a meeting of developing countries called the G15 and so on. And he said, she complained, you cannot, rely on the Iranians. They say one thing to the EU, they say something else to the Russians, and then they say something to the Chinese, and they know to whom they say should say, which is the atomic agents, and so on. Okay, blah, 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 blah. And we were seeing in the meantime that they were slowly moving into the direction of the three basic requirements, abandoning the previous arguments against them. So she said that, and I said, well, okay, we'll try, because these are very verifiable. They don't accept, then we'll see. And when she finished this part about the unreliability of the Iranians and so on, she mentioned two other aspects, which are important in themselves, as I said, which were the fact that Iran had started enrichment at 20%, very low quantities yet, but it started, which is much more dangerous for some reason. It's much easier to go from 20 to 80%, which or 90%, which is weapons grade, than going from 4 to 20. I don't know exactly why, but it is like that, and people of our own atomic agency explained me that that was a fact. So they had started that. And on the other hand, there was also another important aspect. When the agreement was originally proposed, Iran had more or less 1,200 kilos, so the agreement was precise to take all of it. At that time, Iran had about 2,000 kilos. Every estimation, it would be still very important to take out the 1,200 kilos, because then it would be much more difficult for them, and there would be big limitations. Anyway, and I said, well, I agree with you. I mean, we were on a first name base. Hillary, I agree with you. Two things. First, this is meant, actually President Obama had stressed that, this is meant as a confidence building measure, so it's not solving all the problems, and I think we can deal with it. I'm pretty sure, because I had already discussed with Iran some of these problems, pretty sure we'll be able to solve the other problems once we have that. And second, Hillary, these two points are not mentioned in President Obama's letter. Well, when I said that, I'm saying exactly what I felt. Maybe I'm influenced by my own impressions, I don't know. There followed a silence, a kind of prolonged silence, which I have trouble in interpreting, and I try to have some interpretations which appear in the book. And after the silence, she moved to another subject and said, well, since you're going anyway to Iran, please help bringing back our hikers. You may remember that there were these three hikers. Actually, we did help, and we did bring one, and then the other two came later on. But anyway, actually, I even received a small gift from the mother of the hiker, the first one. Her name is here. The last name is Shord, S-H-O-U-R-D. So actually, we did that. So, and then we got the agreement, as Obama had asked, of course with some rhetoric, emphasizing the sovereign right of states to have enrichment for peaceful purpose in accordance with the NPT, because NPT allows that. But that was not. In the concrete points, it was 1,200 kilos in Turkey immediately, and with a letter to the atomic agency that Iran wrote 7 days after we left Iran. So it was everything that was there. I knew already that Hillary would have problems. She was the first person I took the initiative of calling to make sure that she would know. And I did, I spoke briefly with President Sarkozy, because President Lula decided to talk with him. And when I was making the interpretation for French, and then President Lula, talk yourself. So I talked to President Sarkozy, but the first person I had the initiative of talking was Hillary Clinton. When I left Iran, I don't remember at what time it was, but it was very, maybe it was a time difference, it would be very early morning here in the United States, in Washington. So I asked our ambassador, woke up our ambassador, who was Mauro Vieira, who is now our ambassador to the United Nations, and I asked him, well, get in touch with the State Department, because I'm going back to Brazil, I'll have a stopover in Madrid, and from that will be the moment in which I would like to talk with the Secretary of State. So he did, and so I talked to her. Well, we had a talk, and when we finished the talk, some advisors were with me. I said an expression that's very common in Portuguese. I don't think it is common in English, which is about her attitude was "não li e não gostei." I haven't read it, but I didn't like it. You know, that's a very common expression, that, because she had no time to analyze the said, "Oh no, you go on with the sanctions route and so on." It is true that in the past, the United States have always said that they would pursue the two routes, and for several reasons, which I explain here, also because the United States got the support of Russia and China, to some extent bought the support of Russia, because Russia was exempted from some of the sanctions, or the unilateral sanctions that the United States was presenting. So it put, including the provision of material for the nuclear reactor in Iran. Now anyway, so the fact is that, and some of the sanctions went in, for the first time in our history, actually Brazil, together with Turkey, voted no in a resolution that eventually passed. We have voted no to other resolutions, and we had maybe abstained to some resolutions that eventually passed, but we never had voted no to a resolution that eventually was carried. So that was a very special moment, many criticism in the Brazilian media. But the attitude in international affairs was different. Of course, the U.S. government was very furious with us and said that when I presented my version of what had happened, put in doubt some of the things that I had said or the Brazilian government was saying, and I was forced actually to leak the letter that we had received, because then the letter was very clear. It didn't leave margin to any doubt. So this was like that. And there are many voices here in the United States. I mentioned Tom Pickering, for instance. I mean, a not unsuspected voice. You cannot be accused of having sympathies for the Ayatollahs or anything like that. He wrote saying, well, he didn't say it's a marvelous agreement. He said it's a good basis or something like that. It has 80% or 90% of what we want. I don't remember the precise thing. He and about 10 other people who work in disarmament and non-proliferation, Roger Cohen, the very famous journalist who writes for the New York Times, who was no friend of Iran, who had been very critical, actually, of what happened in the election, in the one that Mousavi lost to Ahmadinejad. He said, I mean, the title of his article was "Moving the Goalposts." So the objectives had been changed. Well, when we got what was asked, he said, oh, it's not that enough. We want something more. So, and El Baradei, who had been the director of the Atomic Agency until very recently, and who got even the Nobel Peace Prize for working on the Iranian questions, said, well, if the proponents don't accept this, is because they cannot take yes for an answer. Well, this was El Baradei. These are three unsuspected voices. Actually, since the interview of El Baradei appeared in a Brazilian paper in Portuguese, I went into the trouble of calling him, he was no longer the chairman, to be sure that he had said that, with that translation that I'm giving in English. So, and it was like that. So we were very, very comfortable in having done that. Just to finish with Iran, and then I'll make a short note on Latin America and South America, because this is, after all, Latin American studies. But anyway, well, it's important to see that a South American and a Latin American country can do things like that. And actually, for instance, one who had very praising words, among others, was the President Mujica of Uruguay. Said, we are all proud, we are proud of South Americans to be able to work on these things and so on. And we did not exactly the same thing, but we had important actions also in relation to the Middle East peace process and so on. Well, but just to finish the story here, if you want to read it, it's in detail there, but anyway, well, the sanctions were imposed by a resolution which was approved just 3 or 4 weeks after our agreement. But 1.5 years later, or 2 years later, less than 2 years later, I was Minister of Defense, no longer dealing with these subjects directly, not even indirectly, because. And I read an article. I'm not sure now if it's an article or an interview. I have to see here. Here it says exactly what it was, in the Financial Times, with Anne-Marie Slaughter, who had been planning advisor or planning secretary, whatever the name, for Hillary Clinton. Of course, Hillary Clinton was no longer Secretary of State, and she was no longer there. Well, that appeared in something like November 2011, and because the pressures were increasing, as they had existed before, the many aspects that I tell of my conversations with the Egyptians and other things about the pressures to bomb Iran, even before that. But anyway, the pressures were growing to bomb Iran because it was really considered an existential threat by Israel, and the United States tended to agree with that. So the pressures to bomb were very strong. Anne-Marie Slaughter wrote an article. I hadn't met her. I mean, at least I didn't know. I don't know. I met her later. So she wrote an article or gave an interview. I think it's an article that she's very preoccupied with the situation. And in the end, well, we need to find some ways to come back to the diplomatic solution. And maybe it's time for us to revisit that proposal made by Brazil and Turkey. Well, she had been the planning secretary of Hillary Clinton, so she was not someone speaking from, let us say, a balcony or whatever. She was someone who was there and knew precisely what it meant. And the fact is that, not because of her article probably, not because of, the fact is that some months later or 1 year later, the agreement, that there were conversations were restarted between the so-called P5+1, the five permanent members, plus Germany, but actually it was the United States who conducted the negotiation, and it resulted in the famous complicated name, which doesn't mention nuclear and doesn't mention Iran. It's the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, JCPOA, something like that, was signed. Actually, very, very interesting, because today, looking at the news, and I was reading a comment, I think it was one, don't know if it's the first, but I mean, there must be a periodic review of whether Iran is complying with the agreement, with their obligations, with its obligation, the agreements, and the report by the U.S. government. Yes, it is complying, and of course, and so, well, people say, well, is the agreement the same? No, the agreement is not the same. The agreement that was made during the later on, 5 years later, is much more complex, but it's more complex on the two sides, because there are obligations that Iran takes, gets in that agreement, which didn't appear. I mean, advantages. For instance, there is no talk about abolishing sanctions in the agreement that we had proposed. I'm not saying that it's not right. I think eventually you had to come to that. But we said to Iran always, no, this is a confidence-building gesture, so you cannot ask for anything. It's just, you ask for understanding, and then we go on. At that time, the estimates were that Iran had about 2,000 kilos of low-enriched uranium. I am not sure, but what I have read different things, but at the time of JCPOA was signed, Iran had about 8,000 to 10,000 kilos, so much more complex problem. And the points that that were object of criticism in relation to us were the same that were raised against Obama. Actually, oh, you can't rely on them, and so on and so forth. And the simple reply to that, which is in our mind, and I read that in an editorial later on of the Financial Times, is that that's the basic tenet of disarmament: trust and verify. Well, if you don't trust, you can't negotiate. But of course, if you don't verify, the risk is very big. So these are the two things, and that's what actually the Financial Times, the New York Times, and others were defending. And actually, with a further point, because when this agreement actually came about, 2014, I believe, there was a first version and then the complete one. First there was a joint plan of action, then there was the joint comprehensive plan of action. And when it was really finished, it was the positive role that Iran could play in trying to solve Syrian question. Because, you know, it has a big influence, everybody knows, in Syria, and you cannot ignore. I mean, I remember talks I had myself, I'm not speaking for him, I'm speaking for myself, and when Kofi Annan, who had become the former Secretary General, but had become the envoy by Ban Ki-moon to the Iranian question, to the Syrian question. And I said, but if you don't have Iran on the table, you'll never solve that. Because, you know, even if you don't like them, they can be the spoilers. So you have to discuss with them. So anyway, and this was all, and to my great surprise, editorials, I don't remember precisely which, but of these respected newspapers like New York Times, Financial Times, which are the two that I read most, maybe even the Washington Post, I cannot be sure, had exactly the same argument. Maybe it's time to call Iran to help with the Syrian question and so on and so forth. No, why am I saying all that? Because this was an example in which a South American country, which is there in a forgotten region of the world, forgotten even for good reasons, because we don't have wars and we don't have so many, we are not a threat, direct threat anyone to anyone. It is important, and that's why President Mujica said, oh, well, we are so proud, and so on. And we had done similar things, not of the same size, maybe, or importance, but we have been active, for instance, in the Israeli-Palestine question. Brazil, for instance, was invited to this Annapolis conference that took place in 2007, still the Bush administration. And I will not even mention the Doha Round, because that's, you know, trade negotiations are so boring that when I started, before I finished the first phase, people would be already sleeping. So, but I tried to make it as interesting as possible when I wrote the book by a little bit by analyzing the characters that are involved in the process also, because this is also an important part of history. I mean, and also, let's say, something that applies to any negotiation, the confidence that you have to inspire, even in your adversary. I mean, you have to know that what you say is valid, no? And the other should rely on that. And this is a very important thing that appears a lot in the trade negotiations. Trade negotiations are very rough, actually, because most people only deal with trade. In my case, I dealt also with international relations of other aspects, so I had to be a little kinder. But the trade negotiators are really, really rough, and I had to be rough as well. There was a moment in which a negotiator came to me and said, oh, you're so rude. And I said, well, I don't think myself as a person who is rude, but anyway, you have to be. But so this is basically what I say here, just to mention two episodes, maybe not long, in relation to the Middle East. We started that relation basically because Brazil has 12 million people of Arab origin in Brazil, who has pointed out to me by a Lebanese minister. First time I went way back in 93 to or 94 to Lebanon, we had twice as many Lebanese in Brazil as in Lebanon, just to give an example, and about 2 million Syrians and so on. Some Palestinians, I think Chile has more Palestinians than there are in Brazil, but there are also Palestinians in Brazil. So anyway, so that was a good reason, and the commercial interests, economic interests, and cultural interests, there were many other things. But as we moved along, we got also involved in discussions of very many aspects. So Brazil was invited, as I said, to this Annapolis conference. I had many occasions, as you said, to discuss with Netanyahu, but previously also with Olmert. At some point, I brought a message from Bashar al-Assad to Olmert in relation to the Golan Heights, the discussions, which actually took place with the was called proximity talks with the help of the Turks. And then two or three years later, when it was no longer possible for the Turks to be participating because they were too critical of the Gaza, the attacks on Gaza and so on, there was the famous episode, the Flotilla of Freedom or something like that. Actually, the episode happened a little later, but it was in that context. Netanyahu, of all people, asked, well, Lula was facing him. Lula, by the way, made the first state visit by a Brazilian president to Israel. And so there was nothing anti-Israel in our policy. But so Netanyahu asked, addressing himself to Lula, but it fell to me because immediately Lula pointed to me, asked us to try to restart the negotiations with the Syrians about the Golan Heights border. I think they didn't want to have fights with everyone. But anyway, and I did. And actually, I did. And I am going to say something. Maybe I shouldn't say, but I mean, since it's not being taped, I'll say. No, at a certain point, he said, but to whom should I address? Because well, he was prime minister. I was foreign minister. You know, and I was very respectful of all these niceties of diplomacy. So phone direct to me. Why? I don't know. That you have to look in history who was the foreign minister in Israel and so on. So anyway, at the same time that I was discussing, Netanyahu was asking me to do something, one of the Brazilian magazines, very right-wing one, published, but it's the most read in Brazil, published a photo, myself side by side with Ahmadinejad as the two big enemies of Israel. I can't believe it, and I was working to do precisely what Netanyahu was asking. But you know, people didn't want
Brazil to play a role in international relations, because it's risky, and because it's risky for their particular interests, because their particular interests are normally linked to some other interests which are not Brazilian. That's the real crux of the matter. And they prefer to have a dependent country, because for them, it's more comfortable. So, anyway, so that's what I did. I now want to just say two words about Latin America and South America, because why was it possible? Many reasons. I have already stated the characteristics of Brazil and why we could be there, but very important, because we worked for peace and cooperation in Latin America, but I would say even more specifically in South America. But generally Latin America, we helped in the process of integration, we tried to do our best in Mercosur. It's not easy, it's very thing, it's difficult. Look at the European Union, what's happening, it's everything is difficult. But we are able, for instance, to create, I believe it's the only in the world among developing countries to have a fund to help the poorer economies. We created that, which allowed, for instance, to have high voltage line of transmission from a dam which is in the border between Brazil and Paraguay and the capital. There was this absurdity that Paraguay was owner of half of the biggest energy producing in the world, dam in the world, still is. The Three Gorges is bigger in size, but in terms of production of energy, Itaipu is still the biggest, or at least it was until very recent. And Paraguay had half of it, and its capital, 150 miles away, didn't have energy the whole day. They had, so it's impossible, because there was no voltage. So that was something that we did, among other things. So trying to work, and I always say, I think you have to be also generous in foreign. You can't be naive, but you have to be generous in foreign policy. Oh, generosity is not. No. Generosity is looking at your interest at the long run. So that's what we try to do in South America, especially with the countries like Bolivia also, which had the problem over the gas. And sometimes it requires quite a lot of patience, because it's not easy. When Petrobras now is poorly, has been attacked for other reasons, but Petrobras, when Evo Morales nationalized one, and nationalized in a very, let us say, not nice way, because put soldiers and so on in a refinery, he could have just discussed with us, but I think he wanted to make a show, and I said, attacking Petrobras is like attacking our football national team. You cannot do that. I mean, at least you talk and so on. But anyway, because we were able with UNASUL, later on with the CELAC, UNASUL is the first time ever there is an organization created by a treaty involving all the South American countries. In 200 years of independent life, you have sub-regional agreements, or agreements linked, for instance, to the Amazon, others to the River Plate, you mentioned two that Brazil participated in, but of course you have other things in the Andean part, but not one single treaty involving the whole of South America. That happened in 2008 when we created UNASUR. And then to make sure that we are not only treating with South America, we have the end of the same year, the first ever meeting of Latin American and Caribbean countries without the patronage of either the United States or Europe. Not that we are against having the relations, we always went to the hemispheric conference and so on, but we are different. I mean, we are developing countries, we are all developing countries, we have similar problems, which are not the same as the ones that rich countries like those in Europe or the United States and Canada have. So these things made it possible for us to be in the world at large, I say, or to participate, as I say, using the famous phrase of Rudyard Kipling, the great game of international politics. Rudyard Kipling coined this expression in relation to the road to India, really, and the fights between the Russian Empire and the British Empire for Afghanistan, and the problems that are still there, all the time. Anyway, so that's what we did, and we did with great determination, because as I say always, foreign policy you cannot do only with your head, you have to do physically. You have to have, for instance, this first conference between South American and Arab countries, also something that had never before. In one day, in a certain moment, I visit 10 countries in 10 days.
One day I had, maybe that's common for the American Secretary of State, but for a Brazilian ministry that was not common at all. So one day I had breakfast in Qatar, had lunch in Kuwait, and I had dinner in Lebanon. And I wished to proceed to Tunisia, but then the crew said it was not possible, that the Air Force crew don't want. So that's how we acted, and we could only do that. And I always had my looks back to what's happening in the region. I was, remember, to just mention one fact, which I somehow referred to already, I was in a deep negotiation about trade in Geneva, when actually Susan Schwab was being presented to us as the new USTR. Rob Portman was there, because he was the one who preceded her. And in the midst of her, I have received a call, actually from Dilma Rousseff, who was then, I'm not sure she was already the head of the chief of staff, or if she was the minister of mines and energy. But she was in New York, and she had the news that Evo Morales had nationalized had started the nationalization of gas. Well, so that's how we had to work all the time. And I think I think most of the Brazilian people, to be quite honest, is proud of the Brazilian foreign policy, because they want to recognize themselves as someone worth and someone who can speak his or her voice in an appropriate way. Without going into details, may disagree with this or that, but anyway, that's the basic feeling. But it was not the feeling of the Brazilian elite. So when there was this impeachment recently, and there was a change in the foreign minister, at least in the beginning, an announcement of a total change in foreign policy, the idea of closing embassies in Africa, they didn't concretize, by the way, because it's not as simple as they think. Anyway, Brazil had, when I got there, I think 17 or 18. He knows better than I, because he did the research. I just did the things, you know. I didn't count, make an accounting. So you ask Carlos for the precise number. I think we had 18 embassies in Africa, and when we left government, we had about 36 or 35 or 38 embassies in Africa. So that's a big thing. And then you to see how the papers are, they say, well, why Brazil has 38 embassies in Africa? That's more than Germany. And I said, well, it's not my knowledge that half of the German population is of African origin. Brazil is the country in the world with the biggest African population after Nigeria only. No African country even, and the United States, which of course have many people of African origin, have more than Brazil. So that's a good reason to be present in Africa among many others. So I wrote, but when this started, this change in foreign policy and things that were being announced, all this pressure on Venezuela, I don't want to go into the merits, but I don't think to solve problems by isolating countries and much more by excluding yourself from any possibility of mediation. I think one of the scandalous things nowadays is that Brazil, which is the largest country in South America, the largest in Latin America actually, but I mean half of South America in terms of size, which large border with Venezuela, and Brazil has no say whatsoever in the attempts of dialogue undertaken by the Vatican, undertaken by UNASUR, or undertaken by even the former Prime Minister of Spain. So, but when these changes were announced, or apparently were becoming, I wrote an article which was called A Sharp Right Turn in Foreign Policy. And that article appeared, I didn't say foreign policy, I said Itamaraty, because the name that we are, like the Quai d'Orsay in France, Itamaraty is very well known by that name, a sharp right turn in Itamaraty. And the article I finished, I go on speaking about the different things, and then I say, well, the Brazilian elite and the Brazilian media can be quiet now, they can be calm, they can be reassured. Brazil will no longer do anything similar to making proposals about the nuclear program in Iran. We'll not be meddling with the Middle East at all. We'll go back to that small little corner from which we should never have gone out. Well, you know, it's interesting because never an article that I wrote as foreign minister raised so many furious replies that I was nothing. You know, I had no minister. I was no longer minister of defense. I was nothing. So, what was the influence? But I think. Why was the furious? Because that touched really a sore point. I mean, they knew it was true that the main thing they wished was Brazil to become smaller and more mediocre as it to a large extent, have been in a part, at least, of our history. Thank you.
We have time for some questions. We're going to group several questions together, so I would ask everyone to be brief so we can get as much conversation as possible. We're a bit time limited, so any questions or comments? Yes?
I have a question about your relations with Cuba. I understand Brazil paid to renovate the Mariel port and finance a $700 million line of credit and other projects as well. I was wondering if you could talk about that briefly in terms of if it's just a straight loan, or do I have obtained a financial interest in the port, or obtain fees?
Or do you obtain what?
In the port. You know, Puerto de Mariel in Cuba, is it just a straight line of credit?
It's a line of credit, but anyway, I'll reply to that, yes.
With interest, or do you obtain fees from the
paid
operation
what?
Of
the port? Fees. Oh. Fees, or, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I wonder if you can talk to us a little bit about the role of Brazil-China relations.
Brazil?
China. Mm-hmm. Of course, building, you know, BRICS and so forth is a huge part of the assertive foreign policy that you've developed. On the other hand, key moments, for example, restriction of foreign investment in farmland in 2010 was very much seen as sinophobic, as fear of Chinese land grabbing. They're looking at the follow, you know, they bought Africa, they want to buy Brazil. On the other hand, there were high hopes for huge investments, some of which in Petrobras came through, but railroads and a lot of other infrastructure hopes are still nowhere to be seen, and now with this new right-wing administration, of course, that seems to be out. But I wonder if you can tell us how this whole construction of BRICS and both the fears and also the possibilities that Brazil-China relations can play as strategic partnership.
Okay. And this will be the final one. Yes.
Yeah, so I'd like to come back to the Iran negotiations.
Please, if you can stand up and speak loudly, because I have a hearing problem.
Yeah, I'd like to come back to the Iran negotiations, because I lived in Brazil at the time, and I remember the big criticism in the media. Especially
I'm not sure I heard you well.
Of the Iran negotiations and a big criticism in the media.
Yes.
In the media at the time was that they pointed out that Brazil, even though it had a large Muslim population and a lot of
a large Muslim population.
And a lot of social problems, that Brazil was pretty absent from terrorism or recruitment to extremist organizations. And part of the criticism, I don't know if I agree with it, was that by meddling with the negotiations, you could bring this problem into Brazil.
Would bring terrorism to Brazil.
Yeah. So I'd like to ask you two questions. So the first is if
you could keep it to just one.
One question. Yeah.
Yeah. So do you have anything to say about?
I have many things to say, but I won't say.
I have one quick comment. You mentioned going to 10 countries in 10 days. We have three countries in a single question: Cuba, China, and Iran.
No, very good. Cuba. We try to have the best possible relations with Cuba. I must say that was not only a creation of the PT or ideological sympathy. I don't exclude that there was some sympathy also by many circles in Brazil with Cuba. But for instance, when I was minister for Itamar Franco, which was a centrist government, Brazil acted in a very determined way to improve the relations with Cuba and to avoid its isolation from Latin America. I just give one example, which is an interesting one, by the way, not much mentioned. Cuba was at that time the only, let us say, meaningful, well, all countries are meaningful, but let us say, with the exclusion of countries very small, that had not signed to the Tlatelolco Treaty, which is the treaty banning nuclear weapons from Latin America. It was the only Latin American country. And Argentina and Brazil had recently signed, and I think Chile also came at a later point, because it was all mutually conditioned to some extent. And so when I was foreign minister working for Itamar Franco, I went to Cuba, and I went to Cuba, and I brought a letter from President Franco. It was not President Lula, President Franco, in which he says that that was a moment in which Cuba was being very much isolated in Latin America. I think at that time there was no axis of evil, but it was a similar thing of whatever. And so I came to, with a letter of President Franco, which proposed, I mean, to replace, let us say, this confrontation by cooperation, but asking two things. One was one gesture in human rights. I can leave it for another moment if you are interested. But the other one, which was very important and which materialized very in a very precise way, which was that Cuba should adhere to the Tlatelolco Treaty, should be part of the Tlatelolco Treaty. And this is an interesting thing because this was filmed by this dialogue. Mm-hmm. Fidel Castro, and that was the time of the World Cup that took place here in the United States. Mm-hmm. And it was actually the day of the match between Brazil and the Netherlands. And it was a problem because Cuba was having shortages and so on. No, but you'll have all be able to watch the game. And you may have some surprise. Mm-hmm. I was told. So what happened? You know, I'm sorry to say this so long because I'm a storyteller. That's what I am now. And so when I was there, the surprise was that Fidel Castro came to watch the game in the Brazilian embassy where I was. So I handed him the letter. He read it. That was before the match. At that time, we were alone. He read calmly. And then was the match. And then there was a cinegraphist from Globo with a reporter, actually Paulo Henrique Amorim, but he's not my relation. I mean, I've never had personal relation with him, but not my relative. So they filmed some of the scenes in which Fidel Castro was, supporting Brazil, sometimes in the wrong moment because he doesn't know anything about football. He knows only baseball, so he made the confusion. So, that was a good shot. No, that was not a good shot. But anyway, so but then he was very glad that Brazil won and so on. And so the reporter asked him about the football. And then he said, but we know also that, because that also had been leaked, we know also that the foreign minister brought a letter from the president asking Cuba to become part of the Tlatelolco Treaty, which bans nuclear weapons. And what is your reaction? And Fidel Castro said, well, I don't think this is a moment to make a concession to the United States. And I was always a bit, how should I say, I'm saying more maybe than I should. I said, but that probably was the TV on, so that you can find in the Globo, it wasn't fantastical. And I said, but Mr. President or Commander, I don't know how I address him, President, this is not a concession to the United States, that's a gesture towards Latin America. And Fidel Castro looked at this relatively young minister, 50 years in Brazil, was very young, for him it was very young anyway, and he looked at me and said, well, maybe the foreign minister is right. And 3 months later, his foreign minister came to Brazil and handed a letter to Itamar Franco. Actually, Itamar Franco was in his hometown, Juiz de Fora, and he handled, actually, it's the most important political event that ever happened in Juiz de Fora, I believe, international event at least. He was handed a letter in which Fidel Castro says that he will sign. And actually, 4 months later, we were no longer in government, he actually signed. So this was not, so just to say, contrary to what many people think, that the relations in Brazil and Cuba actually Cardoso sent one of his best friends as ambassador to Cuba as well, Luciano Martins, a very important social scientist, by the way. And so we also continued with that. We had several loans to Cuba, which were always paid absolutely on time, even for buying food, for instance. And when it came to them, we decided to support. Also because it was benefiting a Brazilian company, of course. There's nothing criminal about that. That's what the United States does all the time. I remember I remember the phone calls and the letters written by Hillary Clinton or to be honest, I think both Hillary Clinton and Condi Rice for us to buy U.S. Jets for our Air Force, and in previous times also for Raytheon to win the bidding in relation to this program in the Amazon, of radars in the Amazon, that was still in my first incarnation. So this is what, so we support it. And the as far as I know, at least, all the payments were being precisely done. Well, the interest rate is probably lower because we have, as many countries have, a policy of having lower interest rates when it is the case of developing countries, of other developing countries. The OECD itself has a rule for that. We are not members of the OECD, but we largely follow that. So I think there's nothing absurd, and actually, we had a lot of interest in having economic relations with Cuba. We knew that Cuba would someday, and it will be someday, will certainly democratize fully. And we actually, there are other aspects that I can't mention yet here, but I mean in relation to that, our efforts in that regard, and in relation to the Human Rights Commission and many other things. But we wanted to be present when that happened, because I always said Cuba will be like Vietnam. Well, it will be like one of these Asian countries, because they have a very high rate of education, a very good state of health. So all these things, and the income distribution is more even than in most Latin American countries. One of the worst, by the way, is Brazil. It improved a lot during the Lula and Dilma government, but still it's like that. So we want to be there. And when specifically in relation to that part, I said them, but specifically in relation to that part, it's very interesting because in my reasoning, I don't remember if I said that publicly or not, but that's what I thought. This is a way of inserting Cuba in the world affairs, in world currents, because it's a deep water port, and a deep water port is not necessary for you to export, I don't know, some bananas or something to Nicaragua or to Venezuela. That was, of course, for Cuba to be closer economically to the global world, and certainly to the United States. So that's how I saw the whole project, the whole thing, and that's how I see it. Nowadays, I have to say, because this is a parenthesis, every action that was taken in foreign policy, because of other reasons maybe, are being criminalized. So what we do is exactly what other countries do, or what other countries should do. I mean, the king of Sweden, when he comes to Brazil, you think he goes there only because he thinks that Brazil is nice or because his wife was born in Brazil? No, he comes there to speak about Saab. And when the king of Spain went to Brazil, of course, maybe not him personally, but the people who are around him are speaking about roads and other civil engineering work. So that's what happened. I mean, nothing absolutely contrary to ethics or to legality or anything like that. China. Well, China is an exceptional case in all respects. So I must say, when we started our efforts in the beginning of the Lula government, China was part of what we call a diversification of our economic affairs. Well, now I think we have to look at China in a different way, because it grew so much that I think we have to diversify in different ways. So our exports and imports increased exponentially. Of course, we even became very dependent on the exports of commodities to China, and all that happened, and you know all that story. And when China contracted, that had a big impact in Brazil, still having. There was nothing about being left-wing or right-wing and having China coming to Brazil, and there was nothing, I would say, specifically Sinophobic when there was these restrictions. Maybe it was used because it's easier. If you go to the press and say, oh, be careful, the Chinese will occupy our territory, then all the media become excited. If you say the Americans, say, well, this guy is anti-American, you know. So that maybe was used also, but the concern, I was Minister of Defense, the concern we had was really not selling land, especially the Amazon, and especially in uncontrolled ways, to whoever. I mean, there was a parliamentary member of parliament, I believe in Sweden or Norway, who wished to buy land in the Amazon also. And actually, it's very badly regulated, and I think the present government is trying to make it worse, actually. But anyway, So nothing against China. I don't think even, and I think even the present government, I don't think they will in any way, again, I don't like them at all, as you know. I don't think it's a legitimate government. I think it's doing, Brazil is going backwards in terms of social equity, in terms of many aspects, in independence and so on. But I don't think they would reject China money because they're such a need of money. I mean, they're selling everything, so whatever, I don't know. Maybe someday you go to the sugar loaf, you'll see buy Coca-Cola or drink Coca-Cola or some such Chinese drink, I don't know. The other question was in Iran. No, I mean, I don't know what media you are referring to. No, Brazil doesn't have a big Muslim population. We have a very big Arab population, but nothing against, but by coincidence, most of them are Christians. By the way, the Lebanese and the Syrians who came to Brazil or to Chile, most of them are of Christian origin. They fled the Ottoman Empire. There is a Muslim population in Brazil, but I don't think it's much less than half of a 0.1%. So that's not a reason. So this is the kind of stories that are told, like, that we might attract terrorism. You never saw that way. I don't know what happened in the past, and I cannot judge the past. I don't see Iran nowadays as a supporter of terrorism. I think as it was a total, I wouldn't say lie, because lie is too heavy a word, as it was a total misperception of the reality to say that Iraq was a big supporter of terrorism. It was not, because it's not, actually it is not in the mindset of dictators to support terrorism, because very often it turns against themselves. You know, in certainly the case of Iraq, terrorism didn't exist in Iraq. It started to exist after the bombing of Iraq and after the defeat of Saddam Hussein. I'm not praying Saddam Hussein at all, but what I'm saying is that when you don't bomb a country into democracy, no way, that doesn't happen ever. And second, if you destroy the state structure in a country, you have to prepare for what come later. Most of you have studied political science, have read Hobbes, Thomas Hobbes, the famous, so, and you know what exists when there is no state. I mean, people complain today about Iraq, about Libya. Maybe Syria is a bit different. I don't want to go into that because it would be too complicated. But certainly in Iraq and in Libya, the absence of state fostered the existence of terrorism, the increase of Al-Qaeda. But Al-Qaeda nowadays is almost seen as a moderate thing, because people, the things they do, ISIS didn't exist. And people look for historical reasons in Salafism or Wahhabism or whatever. And that's only part of the truth. But the fact is that the absence of a state structure made it possible for the more fanatical or whatever movements to take hold and to do what they're doing.
Unfortunately, we're about out of time. I just want an announcement and two very brief comments. The announcement is we have Acting Globally up here if you'd like to purchase it. And the very brief observation I wanted to make is Ambassador Amorim mentioned in passing the Treaty of Tlatelolco, which banned nuclear weapons. This is the 50th anniversary of that treaty. We recently had former U.S. Secretary of Defense at the Center for Latin American Studies, Bill Perry. He said the Treaty of Tlatelolco is the most important treaty you've never heard of. So you may want to follow up on
that. May I just make an addition?
Absolutely.
Because you're speaking about Latin America and South America, I'll mention something that is almost as important as the Treaty of Tlatelolco, which is that bilateral agreement, which then became quadrilateral, between Brazil and Argentina in mutual accountancy or accountability of nuclear material, because the two countries have nuclear programs, peaceful ones, and I think when people think of Mercosur and the agreement, think of trade. But what made it possible really to put the countries together was this creation of confidence that they have the mutual accounting. And so we created a bilateral agency, and in a unique situation, we have a quadrilateral agreement with the atomic agency, the bilateral agency Brazil-Argentina, and the two countries, by means of which this bilateral agency does most of the inspections on behalf of the atomic agency. And if ever there is an agreement, for instance, of a nuclear free zone in the Middle East or parts of the Middle East, that's an example that we don't ask for copyright, by the way.
Fantastic. And one very brief additional observation. Ambassador Amorim described himself as a storyteller. That he is, but there was a richness and insight into your observations across such a wide swath of material that it was really, I think, the beginning, not the end of a conversation. We appreciate you being here, even briefly in Berkeley, and very much look forward to you coming back. Thank you.